Just something I remembered while I was eating my bit to eat a while ago. When your termite make all these little compost heaps and they take their little fungal spores out of their pockets and put in to digest it for them, they grow mushrooms. And in Africa they grow 7 species of edible mushrooms, and they come up here on the around the mound, and they're gathered by the Africans and eaten, and like the termites themselves, and like the marula fruit, and like the caterpillars. So there's a whole mass of reliable yields coming off these mounds. The marula is being grown in Australia now. It's one of the valuable African fruit trees. And you get amarula liqueur. And it has a strange stone. It has 3 locules and has a long nut like that. And if you press the nuts, you get a oil much better than olive oil, and it lasts, it has a life about 10 times out of olive oil before it oxidizes. So it's a really good cooking oil. And the fruit's beaut, you know, it ferments as it falls, really. If you sit under a marula tree, you want to sit close to the trunk, because pretty soon you're surrounded by elephants coming over to get drunk. And they go tippy toes when they're coming to the tree, because, you know, they know their wives don't approve of them getting pissed. So, but after they get drunk, they're just chattering and smashing stuff and carrying on. You know, it's like being at a pub at closing time, really. I've looked behind me some days, you know, and there's like 8 elephants just standing there, looking at me, flapping their big ears. Oh, piss off, I say, you know. Yeah, marula. And it ferments. And these mushrooms, and they're a large yield, there's a lot of them. Of course, Africans are a bit superstitious. They're supposed to be. Anybody who lives in mud huts and has jet black skin is supposed to be superstitious. And so they gather all those mushrooms, and then we steal away. We sneak away from the mounds, and we cook them inside a hut out of sight, because we have stolen the termites' crop. And we know we have. So we've got to eat it where they can't see us. It's like grilling baby lions. You do it out of sight of their mother. Right. Yes. A friend of mine, Julie First, she's got a nursery over west. She grows marula. We were just talking about Julie somewhere, weren't we? Yeah. She worked in Palestine for a long time, teaching women of Palestine to grow their food. Right, now, before we leave deserts, I want to stress that if you go to 7 or 8 sorts of deserts, the Sonora is a cactus desert. As soon as you go into the Chihuahua Desert, you see yuccas, but they are arborescent yucca. They look like trees. And the minute you leave these, this is the cartoonist's Suaro, and see these, this is the Sonora Desert. You grow Suaro. And this is the Chihuahua Desert. Chihuahua is a little native dog. It's one of those little animals you use those hot plates for. He's an Eton dog. Have any of you read that book called 1421? Who read it? What do you think about that? Yeah, that's the Chinese left that dog there. 1421. You should buy the book as soon as you go home. Gavin who? What is the author's name? Gavin. Spell that. L-double-E? I think he's forgotten who it is, so don't trust that. 1421 will do. Google that. And it's a great book. It tells of the great Chinese fleets that went out in that year. Each vessel was probably 4,000 to 6,000 people on, and hundreds of vessels, and all in different armadas. And it had geologists and artists and astronomers and everybody aboard, and horses and their food. And each vessel also carried otters in the flooded wells of the junks, because they used the otters to round up schools of fish, which they then netted. They were domesticated otters. And they mapped the world. They mapped all of Australia, north to south, both coasts, Tasmania. I think they missed Stanley, I'm not sure. And they gave parts of these maps to others, and quite often some Indians and other races were on board and helped with navigation and things. And they paid a lot of attention to the southern hemisphere, because they had to establish navigation stars down south. They had the polar star up north. What do you call a star when it comes, its apogee is directly above somewhere? That star is, it's a special star for that place. So they had to find, and you can navigate on them. And the pole star, of course, is always over the North Pole, but in the southern hemisphere, they didn't know where any of them were over. So they took Canopus, and they found it's over one little mountain in the Falkland Islands. And they took Crucis Minor, I think, out of the Southern Cross, and it's over the Antarctic continent. So they had to go inland in the Antarctic and find the place where it was at apogee, which they did. So then they could navigate anywhere in the southern hemisphere, naturally. I'm not bad for crossing Bass Strait either, come to that. Been across thousands of times by stars. What am I talking about 1421 for? The dogs. Yeah, the Chihuahua got me under. And recently I went over to Brazil, and we have three teaching centres there. And I went and saw the local farmers, because they're real nice. And they grow coffee, and they roast that coffee, and they grind that coffee, and they make you that coffee. And they put sugar in it, they've grown the cane, and they've pressed the cane, and evaporated the sugar. And the best cup of coffee you ever had. And while I'm there, I'm admiring their livestock. And they were one chook. I'm not very good at drawing. This is an ordinary kitchen table. This is the chook. It's like a cartoon chook, really. It doesn't, you can leave wheat up there. It eats off the table. And it's instantly recognisable as an old Chinese breed. They picked it up in Malaysia, and they left it in South America. And there's another chook, quite small, and its feathers all grow backwards. The fanciers. People who collect weird chooks are called the fancy. And if you know any of the fancy, they have got something of everything. The fancy have the frizzles, but he's very recognisable. He's Chinese. And then they have another chook, which a most ordinary looking chook. His front is just darker than what he is. So if that's light brown, that's dark brown. And he grows, and it's his eggs. His eggs are green and blue and purple and pink. What is he? He's an Araucana, isn't he? And he's Chinese. So the Chinese left all of these in South America and the Chihuahua. They handed over domestic stock. A curious echo of that is our establishment up in Manaus on Amazon. We breed bees and chickens and little pigs, and we hand it over to small farmers. So they all get enough bees, pigs and chickens to make a living. Instead of seeds or little plants, we have a livestock handed out centre. And we've got the bees are tiny, about as big as flies, and they don't sting. If they're annoyed with you, they try and get in your eye and lick up your tears. But they don't sting. And they don't make much honey, maybe half a cup, look for a small hive. But they've bred so many bees and given them so many farmers, they're looking for somebody who wants to buy 1,000 tons of that honey. Beautiful honey. I'll try and sell it for them later. And you can see the pigs are old Chinese breeds too. So the Chinese really traded in pottery and woven stuff and minerals and silk and carried loads of stuff they thought people would like. And they really spread livestock around the villages of the world, actually. And maize. They had maize back in Asia, long before the Portuguese or anybody took it there. So a lot of what we're seeing today is as a result of this vast trading armadas of the Chinese. And you can dig up all that beautiful pottery on the coast, along the coast. And silks. They left a lot of silks. So 1421, it's worth obtaining and reading. You realise Magellan and Cook and Vasco Pajama and all those guys, they were following old Chinese maps. And Magellan knew where Magellan's Straits were. He said, tomorrow we should come to a pass through south of America, north of South America, because he had a map that showed the strait. Nobody discovered anything after 1421. It had all been mapped, and very accurately mapped. So, get that book. I've given you 4 great books. You've got some great reading coming up. I wish somebody had done that for me. What were you about to say? Somebody started to say something? Yes.
It wasn't me just then, but I'm just curious, why isn't that very common knowledge?
Well, just think about it, you know. You've got America and Colombia and all this history and people having, you know, 5th of November and God knows what and making a big fuss about all their favourite heroes. It's been largely...
The same color.
Pardon?
Who were the same colour?
Did anyone understand that question?
They're making a big fuss about their heroes who are the same colour.
Yeah. And short fingernails too. Your average Chinese leaves this one about that long. Usually stimulates the brain with it. They want to maintain their fairy stories. It's pretty sick, actually, that everybody wants you to believe the lies. I've been to America. When is it? The 5th of November? When's Thanksgiving? Whatever. I've been there cooking turkeys, watching the fireworks. I came out of the slums in, what's the capital of America?
Washington.
I stayed in Washington in the slums, and hundreds of cars were being dismantled along the street, and the heroin's out on tables, so you can go along and taste or sniff little bits all the way down the street. The runner is the CIA. The CIA have always run the drugs into America. They pick up the heroin and take it in. The mafia distribute it. And they also, George Bush Sr., he nailed down the cocaine. And he wholesaled that in when he was head of South American operations. That's old George Bush. And I congratulated the Texans. Where was I? In Austin, I think. There were 3,000 of them sitting in a hall in front of me. I said, I'd like to congratulate you. They just elected George Bush. I said, to my knowledge, you're the only country that has, as so far, that has elected a chief drug runner as your president. And they all look at each other, according to reporters, and say, did he really say that? Did he really say that? They didn't know George Bush was a drug runner. How could they have not known that? It's like saying the Chinese didn't discover everything.
In your autobiography,
yes.
You mentioned an American saying to you about the Australian government being dismissed. Can you talk a bit more about the dismissal of the
government
and that's in
your
book?
You
know about that?
Yes, I know all about that. But there it is. It's in that book, which I give. It's a book called The Eagle and the... I'm looking desperately at my wife trying to send her messages. What's that film? The something, Snowman and the... Yeah. There's a film on it, The Falcon and the Snowman. And it, see, you don't know who's sitting in this audience. And when I was in the States, I had three game players from the CIA come and do their permaculture course, and they used to talk to me at off times, and they said, you want to watch it, they're going to chuck your government out soon, we're just playing it now. And the Falcon and the Snowman were the game players, two of the game players in the CIA. And they tried to tell someone to warn us that they were going to get rid of our commie government, Gough Whitlam's government. And they didn't know how to do it. So they went into the Russian embassy and told them to tell us. And of course, the Russians probably playing the same game as the Americans, so they didn't tell us, obviously. And but they did do it in Chile, and that got rid of Pinochet, and they're going to run the same game here, eh?
Allende,
and put Pinochet in, and they're going to run the same game here. I said, well, they're rough on their allies, you know. We're on their side. They've forgotten that or what? So they said, you know, be careful when you go home. But the story is told in this book and in this film. And I knew about it before it happened, but I didn't feel like going home and saying to Gough Whitlam, "You're about to get the axe, Gough." I didn't like Gough Whitlam that much. He's a very haughty sort of bugger. But Americans are always sticking their little fingers in somewhere playing games. Yes, it's a book. Those guys are still in jail, I think. They gave them 18 and 25 years. You can just Google it and get the film. They were idiots. They didn't know how to get messages out. They were okay sitting in their computers in the CIA, you know, planning game playing, but they were unsure how to get out in the real world, warn people. Oh, well, just ignore all that. Get on about your business. Let's just restate something to finish off the dry land. The dry lands are very rich in resources, in adapted animals, adapted large trees, adapted shrubs, adapted grains, adapted bulbs. And by carefully assembling from all the water-deficient areas of the world, you can build a fantastic food system, and you never have to irrigate. Well, if you have termites, the termites will do all your irrigation. The Aborigines love planting acacias that attract the cossard moths because they like witchetty grubs. But the real big mass of grubs are the hepialas, and they live down on the roots. You all know how to get them. You just take about this much soil off around a river red gum and you've got hundreds of tunnels exposed. And you drum them to see who's home. They sound nice. There's a grub down there. They sound dead. They're cold. The grub's gone. So then you get a little reed, tie a knot in it, and lower it down. And you touch ghost moth grub, and he turns around real fast and grabs it with his little mouth, his little pinches. And you tie a knot in it, so you just pull him out. You can't let go. And he goes... He whistles up because he's a tight fit in his burrow. And boom, you can just grab him by the head and eat him. They're as large as a small sausage. So you can eat three or four. I was fishing one day and I got 20 and ate 10 of them. I nearly sicked up. It was like eating 20 sausages, you know. And bad luck to catch what do you call those big fish in the Murray? Yeah, I caught a Murray cod on top of that. And I'm very lucky I didn't end up dead on the banks of the Murray. And then I've met a black woman called Meredith Croponieri, her name was. She's camped under a bridge on the Murray and she says, "Hi, travelling man." That was a good introduction. I says, "How are you?" And she says, "I got the billy on, so I stayed there and camped with her, made cups of tea, and luckily I had a tin plum pudding, so I made plum pudding." And Meredith was a dab hand at catching spiny cray. So in a couple of days, I just had an embarrassing lot of food piling up around me. It really is quite good out there in dry lands. I've forgotten what the name of her daughter was. She said, "Have you met my daughter?" I said, "No, I don't think I have. Is she a Croponieri?" She said, "Yes." I said, "You're a long way from home. Narangeri, they're down on the Coorong at the end of the Murray." She says, "Do you know the Narangeri?" "Yeah." I said, "I do. I know them pretty well." She said, "Yeah, you know where my daughter is?" I said, "No." She said, "How would I know your daughter?" She said, "She's an Indian firewalker." It's this Aboriginal woman's daughter that's taken up firewalking. I said, "What's that like?" She said, "Oh, shocking." She said, "Burnt her feet, got blisters, you know. She's going to give it up." I said, "What happened?" She says, "She met an old firewalker and they soaked her feet in on these crystals and hadn't had a burn since. Actually chills your feet," she said. "There you are, if you want to be a firewalker, soak your feet in Cornish crystals, away you go. No one can catch you." So I never did catch up with her, but I have looked at different circuses and things. We're often finding ourselves in minor landscapes. I had that dreadful question or that dreadful comment made to me once. I landed at Mahé in the Seychelles and there was a message for me, "Don't go through customs, there's a plane waiting for you on the airstrip." I got out and a bloke came there in a half mask, socks like a... tropical executives, they always have socks up to the top of their calves, you know. And in Australia, mainly they got white shoes. We call them the White Shoe Brigade, don't we? The developers. It wasn't quite that bad, but they had very long shorts, not quite to your knees, like the English idea of shorts. Never that long, so his knees sticking out. It took my bags off the plane, took me over to his little aircraft, and we all got in. We were up and flying, and he said, "His Majesty is waiting for you." So that's the time, and I started racking my brains, where's the nearest kingdom? So off we go from Mahé out to the sea. And we went, you know, he said, "You want to fly out?" I said, "Sure, I can do that." So I flew her for a while, and then, you know, coconut palms come up on the horizon. He said, "I'll land it if you like." I said, "I'll be happy if you do that," because there was a little slit in the coconut palms. And you give it real hard rudder right until the minute you drop below the palms and kick her over. And we put her down. And he said, "His Majesty's waiting by the airstrip." So I got out of the plane and His Majesty's just sitting in a little tiny little jeepy thing made in France. And so is Her Majesty. I suppose it's in the big ears, eh? It wasn't big ears. He said, "How are you going?" I said, I'm great. He says, "Good to see you, Bill." I didn't know what his name was. I don't know what to call him. But this pilot kept calling him Your Majesty. After a while he says, "You can call me Sharam." So I did. "Hi, Sharam." And his wife was Niloufar. And he was Emperor of Iran. Oh. And his wife, one of his wives, is the third and least important of his homes down there in the Seychelles. I'm not telling you where in the Seychelles, because he doesn't like you to know. And but there's lots of islands there. You can go and look. You get your head cut off on this one. And I met my first large coconut plantation. I had to redo it. At 80 years, they sort of ceased to yield. So you should be replanting about the 60th year. And you use the old palms to mulch your new crop. So I got it all organised for him. And then I had an awful lot of palm trunks and I built undersea crayfish pens in the corals, and within 3 weeks they were coral covered. So I built high rise for crayfish. It was great. Just spike the crayfish trunks down in the corals, and man, you got in no time flat. They nail them together. I had a great time there. Oh, so where are we? We're out in the Coral Islands. That's the word I'm talking about. I wanted to get to the Coral Islands, and eventually I got there. The blacker flew me out was, who was that guy that used to go to Africa and shoot everything? He had a penchant for shooting things. Lived in Cuba. Hemingway. Yeah, the pilot who met me was Hemingway's pilot. So Sharam had signed him on as being, you know, pretty competent sort of codger, apparently. And he liked my work too. And he said, how much is that to me? And I said, same as everybody, $500 I charge to design your property, you know. No, 500. And he said, 500 what? I said, dollars. And he was very embarrassed, you know. I think he thought I was going to say 500,000 or something. And I was getting on the plane with his cheque when he ran after me and put a newspaper wrapped parcel on my lap in his little plane. And it was the most beautiful carving in ivory, mammoth ivory, of a Persian princess's head. It was just incredibly beautiful. And I'd seen it in a niche in his house. So I think he thought I undercharged him. And rather than trying to pay me, he goes, well, I don't like to have valuable things in my house, I suppose you do either. So I gave it to my son when he got married. He's got to look after it now, poor bastard. Yeah, so now, here we are. We're out on an atoll. Here's the sea. An atoll is sitting on a volcano base. And so it goes down. You go, here's the reef, here's the lagoon, there's the outer reef, here's the island, lagoon, reef, and here is a great depth. I went swimming off there one day and you just go shoot out over the edge. I'm floating along on a board because I was a fisherman, and they probably know that fishermen don't swim. It takes fun out of fishing, I think. And so I got to float around on a board. I went out over the edge and you're looking down and, you know, suddenly it just drops. An endless blue space, and I saw a turtle swimming along here somewhere, and he looked about as big as a blowfly, you know. He's swimming along there, a cliff. So I came back, I thought, and this is where I was building those crayfish log houses. So this is an atoll. Low coral sand, about 2 feet or so, there's a very hard layer called caliche, and the cal means calcium. Caliche, it's quite hard, like concrete. So it's sand above, then caliche, then sand below. Sand above is dryish, the sand below is quite wet. Caliche, if you uncover it, has a hole here and there right through it, a natural hole. Rain falls on the atoll, goes down through the sands, spreads across the caliche, finds a hole and goes down through the caliche. And when it goes down through the caliche, it accumulates below the caliche. So on all atolls, there's a lens of fresh water here. Here's the sea, right? And there's a large lens of fresh water here underneath the caliche. Tapers out, seeps out on the beaches sometimes. All right. You've got to build villages and things on this island. That's all your water. That's your. Where are you going to put the villages? Right in the middle? At the extreme edge. Why? Yeah. Extreme edge, you can't pollute much. Just that bit. But if you put a village here, with sewage and fuels and God knows what, you can pollute the whole limb. So be careful. You've got to be careful. Now, you've just graduated from an Australian Agricultural College or this university, and you're an expert. You go there and he says, how shall I fertilise my trees? And you'll say, oh, whack a few bags of super on. And of course you do. And you know what happens? The whole bloody island turns into concrete and you got to flee. Because they'll send the assassins after you no matter where you go. He didn't want a concrete island. My advice to you is never, ever attend a university or college of agriculture. They make incredible, disastrous decisions. Calcium triphosphate, which is what you form when you put superphosphate on a coral island, is an insoluble cement. So you cement the whole bloody island up. Don't do that. No, we would lose at least one, sometimes two atolls a year to that. Huh, what you got? You got a bit of one?
While you're talking, I'm just going to put Kiribati up
there. Yes, you haven't got an awful lot of elevation here. Kiribati, spelled Kiribati. They just do that so they know you're not from there. You go there and say, this is Kiribati, isn't it? And they'll say, you're not from around here, are you? And there's no more shivery statement than that one. You're down in Texas and some of those places. You're not from around here, are you? I had two friends in a pickup truck. I was in one day, we pull up at a sort of general store and petrol station in a county down Tennessee. A guy comes out, he's got hardly any teeth, and he leans on the car and says, what do you fairies want? You know, it's sort of not a good start to chummy relationship, you know. You're not from around here, are you? Wanna watch out. They're still swinging people in the States, you know, you can hang anyone you don't like. I think that's sort of part of democracy. I've always felt in a true democracy, if somebody annoys the shit out of you, you should be, you know, able to hang them at least or shoot them or something. Isn't democracy sort of expressing your feelings? Freedom to express, yeah. So we've got our water and we can use it We can put a little water spike into it. We can use it, and we can actually increase the storage if we put large artificial tanks and fill them up there and use from those. Because there's plenty of rain falls on most adults in the wet season. It's just not much storage for water. You can't swale, obviously, there's no runoff. And the water leaks out very slowly into the sea through nearly invisible springs, but you can see them underwater. They look like sugar dissolved in water rising out of the sand. They've got a shimmer, the freshwater springs. And some of the Polynesians who've been there a long time, Kluwe guys, they can dive down and locate those springs and actually can fill up, you know, empty coconut shells and bottles from the springs and bring up fresh water out of the sea and other things. That's what you're dealing with. Now, the pH is pretty high. pH is 8 to 10. You haven't had your pH lesson, have you, for a long time? Have you? pH is hydrogen ion concentration. And it's got a scale, 0 to 7 to 14. This is alkaline up here. This is neutral. 7 is neutral. And this is acidic. And where are things? 11, it's the highest I've measured. You can pH of 11 in evaporating dune ponds, and that'll kill most fish and larger organisms. pH of 1.5 or something, you can get it from lime juice, and it will fall as rain in northeast United States. It looks like piss falling on the snow, and you measure it. It's pH 1.7 I've measured, 1.7, and it's from industry. That's what democracy is. You can produce battery acid and rain it all over your neighbour. It'll also dissolve your clothes and makes holes in your dew go all over your car and so on. So in nature, you get pHs raining at extremes, 1.7 to 10. But normally, when you're gardening here, above and below neutral, and preferably a bit below. So a good garden's pH 6. Now, on these adults, the pH is high, it's 8 and 9. If by growing casuarinas and palms and gathering casuarina mulch, and by taking some of the top sand off your caliche and mulch, replace it with mulch, you can get the pH down to 6 on a coral atoll. And the old Polynesians just in their canoes, they had yams and taro and coconuts and stuff. And they'd come ashore, dig holes down to the caliche, cram everything they could into them, any seaweed and logs, and put the coconut in and go away. Come back later and they would have already started subsistence crops. So they got to most adults by mistake and had them planted. Quite often you go onto an atoll, there's no one living on it, probably never has been, and there's quite a few crop plants growing here and there, and you realise some canoe has wandered there at some time over the last 1,000 years and planted taro or planted palms. In that top sand, gardens are not great, but sometimes we clear out quite a bit of the sand and build it up with all the waste we can get our little grubby hands on. And we have a garden down here. And the roots of that garden often find their way through the caliche and into the water table. So you can start growing parsley and stuff down there, which never grows on atolls normally. And as you go up the sides of the banks, you get a rapid pH increase. So you can get a lot of crop at all different pH levels. And keep your buildings central. Always put tanks on your buildings so you're catching the rainwater. Put as many water storage as you can. You can glee this. You can dig a hole in the sand here, and you can gather a lot of green stuff. Dig the hole with very sloping sides and put thick banana leaf greens down and sweet potato leaf and roll it down and then cover it with cardboard or plastic and fill it with water that you pump out of the lens, and it'll hold because that glee is fermenting. You're fermenting vegetation there and you're making a glee. And it's like a gel, and it's organic, produced by rotting vegetation, and it's forever. Once you've established a glee, that's there forever. That won't leak. I put one in the Seychelles. That trip I flew in to see His Majesty. Sharam, Pahlavi, Sharam Pahlavi. Pahlavi is the old language of Persia, isn't it? Also of the peacock throne. And I think Pahlavi was a peacock, wasn't it? Not too many of you met the Shah of Iran, I suppose. It's just a matter of time, you know. Keep wandering men around and bump into him.
Can you do that in other soils apart from the sand?
Mm-hmm. We do it in those awful limestone on the slopes of Mount Wellington, near Hobart. We have to get little ponds in them and they won't really hold water. So we glee them usually with the pretty thick grass, glee in just the plastic on that. You know, if you get enough glass, it'll turn sort of gluey. That's when you pour it full over the plastic. That'll stay forever. Oh, there's your pH. Good. So your atolls are up here. High calcium soils generally, and caliche, that hard pan there, is one of the classic hard pans. It forms because the water dissolves the coral calcium out, takes it down in the sand, and then the water evaporates under the sun. So you've got this rain, evaporation. And what builds up down there is a hard pan of calcium. It's quite difficult to break through. I've broken through it quite a lot. Whenever I plant a coconut, I break through the caliche, make a little hole. and plant the coconut just through the hole in the lens, the water lens. Then what other hard pans are there? Well, when you get to tropical rainforests, slightly acidic rain is pH 5.5. Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're coming this way. Rain is faintly acidic at 5.5, but and the acid is carbonic acid from CO2. And plants like that because it has a good effect on the minerals and carries it for plants. And they always look sprightly after rain. You can water your little heart out with a hose and the plant doesn't look as good as they do after a rain. Plants really adapted to rain. They like that pH. Near factories and that, it can go highly acid. So in America, it's often 2 sometimes. Once it gets to 1.7, you can put in your car battery. So all those lakes up through Massachusetts and Mill Lark and all those areas is totally sterile. And the leaves that fall into them this autumn are going to be there for a century because they're all pickled. And there's no life in them. But here you go. On the shore of every lake, you can buy your fishing licenses. And if you ever caught the fish, it'd be far too acid to eat. It would be like pickled fish, you know, with some pickled onions. There's a lot of facades in this world. Well, I think we're doing pretty well on our atolls, aren't we? We kept our settlement out to the edges. We made sure to catch all the roof water and increase the total water resources. We went down to the Caliche and made home gardens by mulching, and we got the pH to about 6 there, so we had ideal garden soils, which don't occur naturally on those islands. We got adapted trees, we got coconut, and all the citrus will grow once you get the mulch around them. And you've got quite a lot, you've got a whole lot of shrubs on this high part of the beach, which have special uses. One which Scaevola. S-C-A-E-V-O-L-A, frutescens. Sometimes I open the right door for lots of times, but sometimes I can't remember the Latin names. But Scaevola frutescens is pan-tropical, it's right around the world, and you pick a leaf, and you grind it up with half a cup of seawater and swallow it. And bingo, you don't manage to wait for 3 or 4 years. Pick 3 leaves, grind it up with a cup of seawater and swallow that, and you never manage to wait again. Now every Polynesian girl has a drink of this and doesn't manage to wait, say, between 12 and 21 or 22. And has done forever and a day. Scaevola is named after an Indian princess who was cut in half by a jealous lover, and the flower looks exactly like any flower that somebody's cut in half. So it's in memory of her. frutescens, bearing fruit, and also stops you bearing fruit if you're a lady. There are dozens of natural contraceptives, apart from whistle cocking. Whistle cocking, that's pretty contraceptive. You drop a hot coal down the eye of the penis and close it. Put a plug in the base, and when you want to get fertile again, you stick the plug back in and cut the eye open, and away you go. And it's only slight pain. Nice thing about whistle cocking, it's applied to men, see. I don't know how I got that name. I've never known anybody blow on one to see if it whistles.
Bill, here we are digging through the calice. Calice.
Here he is, forking into the calice. He listened to his lesson. I must have taught you that, did I? I did.
Andrew, digging through.
Oh, right. There they go. There's the lads at work in the calice. Down on the hard pans. If you were in the jungle, the wet jungle facing on the Pacific in South America, you go down there, it's not caliche down there, it's glass. Because what's leached there out of the soils is silica. So it goes down that far, and then the water evaporates and leaves it down there, and it's glass. Where was it? Down below Ambato, we had a fuel station, and there's this bloke up there digging across the side of the hill. We went up to see what he's doing. He's breaking through the glass and making little planting pockets and putting soil in and planting trees. And sort of broke our hearts, so we went and joined him. We've broken the glass round the hill in hundreds of rows now, and slowly turned it back to a sort of jungle. But, you know, like caliche's nice compared to silcrete. So caliche is calcrete. Calcium, creted. Concreted. Silica is silcrete. And iron, which occurs in deserts often as a capping, is ferrocrete. And always under iron you find aluminium underbelly. And it's another desert hard pan. So the hard pans all have pretty standard origins and pretty standard locations. Calcrete runs in Australia right to the coast, on the west coast. Wherever the desert meets the coast in South Australia, West Australia, you've got calcrete. And South Australians are very familiar with calcrete. What else you got up there?
I'll just show you a quick sequence of traditional pit gardens of how Polynesian, these exact forms of pit gardens where often the main crop is taro, and you just see a quick shot. It's quite, they're classic traditional pit gardens. There's one there, just on the right side of the path. And here is a whole mixture of taro and edible pandanus, different fruit trees with around the edge, coconuts. Here it's just a mass of taro. It's actually a pit going down to the lens. Here it's quite boggy in the bottom. It's a shallow water there where they're actually into that coral atoll lens, which is the whole life of the island. You can't pollute that lens. And there's no point in swaling. Swales don't work, everything soaks in.
Well, no water running anyway.
There you can see the actual water at the bottom. That is the lens. It's only not even 2 metres down.
No, it's about this far to the caliche.
when you're designing under such tight criteria, it's actually quite easy because you're restricted on what you can do. So you have less choices. You can only work with that lens. And septic tanks are a disaster. And everything you pour on the surface is a disaster.
Yeah. Septic tanks, you blow them up if you see them coming onto the island. Dynamite them. And you never put them in because all you're doing is putting sewage into the lens. So you've got to use dry toilet. And, you know, then you get dig it out every 6 months and put it on your garden or around the trees. But people are very well adapted to adults. They've been there a long time, ever since about 600 AD. And they grow good crops, good subsistence crops. Sometimes in extreme storms, and more often recently, the waves wash over the island. The lens survives that, but the gardens may not. And depend on the frequency, but once a year if they wash over the Tara, I'll take that. But twice a year it won't take it, and you've got to change your root crop over to a salt-tolerant root crop, which is a giant taro, which is planted in little baskets.
Here is a raised garden with shade cloth over the top. This area was actually washed over. Kiribati's highest land on Kiribati is only, well, it's many islands, but on the main island, Tarawa, the highest piece of land is 2 metres. Quite a lot of the land got inundated with salt water. It's going under.
Yeah.
And we put in these raised gardens with a lot of mulch, organic matter, and grew all these different Chinese cabbages and different greens, whole mixture of stuff. And this is a place where cabbages are $16 each. $16 Australian. It's Australian currency on Kiribati. Fresh vegetables are pretty unheard of. There's a lot of breadfruit and there's a lot of banana and papaya. There's a few tree crops. There's very few vegetable crops.
Breadfruit is a staple only for Kiribati and Tahiti. So everybody grows a few breadfruit, but as a staple, it hasn't been generally adopted. Bligh and other people try to spread breadfruit everywhere because as a slave food and got some of it into the Caribbean, but it's never been adopted as a staple there. Coconut, taro, those seem to be popular. There's nothing nicer than taro leaves with little bits of filleted fish in between them, flooded with coconut milk and baked. It's delicious.
This is a shot of palm toddy being harvested off the up in the tree.
Palm wine. Yeah, cut the flower off the end of the flower stalk, which is what you see going into that bottle, and then you paint it with vinegar or any light acid, and stops it coagulating, and it fills bottles up with sweet liquor. And if you want to evaporate it in the evaporation pan for 51 minutes, it turns into sugar. And you get big coils of creamy sugar. But if you want to make toddy, you let it stand around a couple of days, it's beer. In 3 or 4 days, it's really powerful. And you can distill it into arak, A-R-R-A-C-K, favourite drink of your date palm society, Arabs. The men in Micronesia's job is to evaporate the liquor from the stems of the coconut. It takes them several days, and they sit there putting little sticks under big pans. and saves them doing any hard work. So you're sitting around telling lies to each other and slowly evaporating palm sap to a heavy honey-like substance. Men often have interesting jobs. The women have to do all the wood chopping while they're evaporating the coconut milk. Now what do you got?
Same one in tin.
Hmm?
Corrugated iron.
Oh,
version
good.
Of a traditional roof.
Yeah. You can imagine how it is hot under there. Imagine the air rushing in under the eaves and up and out the ends of the roof. And it's quite a breeze. If your roof is low enough and out far enough, it totally shades all walls. There is no sun falls on any of the walls, so there's no radiated heat enters the building. In all tropical buildings, all heat sources are detached from the house. You get it out of the envelope of the house. So you have a little footpath, raised footpath, tippy toe across, a little thatched building out there. And what's in that? It's a laundry, kitchen, hot water systems, out of the house. So you get your heat away because you're cooling this house all year. So whenever you're designing the tropics, here's your house. Your walls are inside that, so you can't see them. You just get a little glimpse of them. The air goes in and out. People can cool down inside. And over here is a detached laundry, kitchen, shower. And in Brazil, which has two climates, a cold and a... There's your house and there's your little kitchen, opens on the back veranda. And here's your outside kitchen here. And there's your, that's your summer kitchen. And this is your winter kitchen. And this is standard design. So you can design for very variable, cold winters, hot summers, just stinking hot all the year, or real cold climates like Tasmania. Which we'll get into later, we'll make you champion house designers directly. So you're not bugging us all the time as to how your house is designed. You will become a champion house designer. They were low islands and atolls. They islands are very interesting. They all have like special animals on them. And another one of those rules is that island animals exhibit either dwarfism or gigantism. So if you go to Madagascar, they got little elephants. The elephant and dwarf hippos. Have you seen dwarf hippos? They have tiny little babies, very cute looking, but they got a hippo nature, so they're very likely to bite you in half when you cuddle them. All islands out on their own, and especially in chains, Coral Atoll is sitting on a volcano which is down here below it and has sunk down. But the high islands like Maui and Hawaii and Oahu, they actually still have the volcanoes there. And many of those are active. So all the Canary Islands do too. Canaries are quite interesting. If you go across the Caribbean, what was that island we were on the Caribbean called? Digger, what a woman. Barbados, we were on Barbados. If you go to the eastern edge of Barbados, which comes in like this, and you walk uphill from the sea, you find great big stones up here, and they're granite, and they're lying on a basaltic basement. They didn't grow there and they weren't left there. They washed up there. And you can find them way out deep down off Barbados to the east. Scary, scary. Right. So, you know, it's a brave man who... What happened to my drawing?
It's gone down. I'll just give him a bit more space
here. It's a brave man who built his house there, isn't it? You know, you wouldn't build a house there because one day a 600-ton pebble might come and drop on you. How did those big pebbles get way up on the top of Barbados? Wave? That would do it. A tsunami would do it. So, having found this effect around Caribbean and south part of the North American coasts, they looked back on the arc where the damage occurs, and you just take back and you point straight at one of the Canary Islands, La Palma, and it's a half island. It has a... It was a large volcano, and that's all that's left. That's gone. And what happens is volcanoes come up and they fire away here and grows, and a lot of this stuff sticks to itself. But there's nothing under it, only sea. And now if you go up to La Palma and look at the crater, you see a little crack running across the crater and down over the island, and it's getting slightly bigger all the time. And this is going to drop off, see? Plomp. And that is a big hole in the sea, and that's your tsunami. And it's going to go. If you go up there, you can still stick stick and plaster over it, in a crack. But you need to rivet it up pretty good if it's not going to go. There are lots of such little, what are they, traps waiting to go off, you know, in the world. Well, this is one of them. And it's going to go any time. But this would be a nice one because the wave is over a mile high at New York. I just strike a New York pose for you. You know, it's sort of like Gotterdammerung. You know, imagine having a surfboard up on La Palma ready to go, you know, and you drop in with the volcano and ride straight for New York. And, and you've got to hit the United Nations building about 18 floors up. What? You know, surprise! Fan bloody tastic. It's interesting. The world is full of interesting things, and it's also full of signs that these things have happened. And down the East Australian coast, there have been 5 such waves in history. We don't know where they're coming from, though. So we'll find out where when the next one comes, I guess. Wow. It's sort of exciting out there on islands and dating things. It's High Islands now we'll go to. they're volcanic, and they do have a feature which low ones don't have. When these things are active and lava pools are pouring down the slope, they often are pouring down underground, and they run out into the sea out of caves, and the larvae disintegrates and turns into black sand and washed ashore if it pours into the sea. But the channels that came down are capped by larvae which cool on top. So the last of the larvae is running down a tube. So say you cut a little slice across here, there's a sea, there's the basalt, there's lava, caves, all around here. And when you go up them a bit, they have very thin lids and you can break your way into them. And the Polynesians got into them from the top and got into them from the bottom, because they're good divers. And down on Molokai, out on Kalapapa, where all the lepers are, where nobody goes for a holiday. I worked there a long time. They got some out there, lava caves, and you've got to row out a little way and dive, and you can go into it. And when the chiefs die, old chiefs, they put them in their canoe with all their goodies around them. I think they added it, yeah. They added all the wives crossways. It's called the straw of the grave bed, and laid the chief on top and floated them all out in the canoe with all his goodies. And then they filled the canoe slowly up with stones and sank it. And then when it was total neutral buoyancy, all the warriors got round and swam the canoe into the bottom, into a lava cave. And when it was right inside, they took all the rocks out and lifted it up and carried it up into the cave. And that's where the old fellas are sitting now, up in their canoes, up in the cave, from the bottom in. And friends who know several of these burials, where they are. So why don't you go and have a look? It's very easy to get drowned like that. And there's big white sharks off there. Just out there with a skip one day. We're in a little canoe, we're fishing. And he's, for some reason, he's got his little diving thing on. I have a rooted objection to immersing myself in cold water. So I wasn't in there with him. He comes up and his little face is stricken. He's clinging on the side. He said, "You should see what's coming up." I said, "What do you mean?" He said, it's like a submarine, but it's got eyes." And at that point, he flung himself into the canoe and I looked down. There was a bloody big shark coming up under Skip's legs. So if you go up these caves, he'd probably be sitting at the entrance waiting for you to come out. It was big. You should see what's coming up. So I thought it was a submarine, but the nose has got eyes. Yeah. The Hawaiians were pretty innovative people, and they obviously had a lot of time on their hands because they invented several things. One was surfing. Had big, heavy wooden surfboards, about 18 feet long, you know, and chop your head off, it hit you. That's all right. They just cook you in the earth up and then. They had sort of like balls this big made out of basalt, which they rolled down tracks down the sides of the mountains. They had all sorts of games. So obviously they were great at game playing. And they had hang gliders. They have a palm, the Olu palm. and it grows on little volcanic peaks off the coast. And they go out there and they weave themselves a pair of wings and a thing to hang on to. And wait till the trades really got hard, they jump off in the trades and try and glide to the main island. And according to my informants, you know, they rarely ever made it. Some did. Most of the time, drop in the sea. Probably something with eyes that looked like a submarine, and then take another fly coming. It'd be like brown trout taking mayflies, wouldn't it? Down the hatch. It was a great fun, I think, in those days, being a Hawaiian. Except if you got captured, in which case you turn into cattle and you get eaten. Right. What? I've hardly started. It's 12:30. Is it time for lunch? All right, bastards. You will now wonder for your whole life what to do on High Island.